and welcome back. So, you know, I've been here all morning. I realize I haven't had a chance to introduce myself formally. My name is Charlie Cabri. I'm the CEO of a company called Say It Now. We use generative AI and emerging technology to allow brands to talk to their consumers using smart speakers and voice assistants. And I'd like to give the panel an opportunity to introduce themselves. After you, Danielle.
Hi, everyone. I'm Danny. I run marketing and growth at an investment and innovation firm called True. So we are sector specialists in retail and consumer.
Oh, thank you, Danielle. Hi, everyone. My name is Sid Chaudhary. I look after MarTech and content ecosystem for Mars Snacking. So some brilliant brands like Snickers and M&Ms. And so it's a very fun place to work. Nice to meet you all.
Actually making me hungry. So I've been here before. So Steve King, I'm the CEO of Dragonfly AI, a technology that can predict where consumers are going to look.
So look, let's bring it back to, you know, let's land this all. You know, you've all been invited to this panel today because you are using AI every day. How is that manifesting in your day to day? What are you seeing? And so how are you using these technologies on a day to day basis?
So for me, it's very much twofold. So my role in marketing and growth, I really use it for content. So at the moment, I'm a team of one working across the whole firm, across three different business units. So anything that I can use that really helps me do my job faster, I'm definitely using. So whether that's drafting copy for social, whether it's, you know, using it as kind of a buddy. So I like to think of it as a draft and craft buddy system. So if I can get it to just churn out a best practice press release for me, and that will save me, you know, a bit of time, I'll do that and then I'll craft it based on the information that I need. Then in terms of our venture capital side of the business, we are seeing a lot of really interesting developments in terms of how we can tap into different user behaviors, how we can, you know, really understand the analytics behind different content before we do it, or different e-commerce strategies and things like that. So quite varied, but we can go into more detail in the panel.
Awesome. Thank you. How about you, Sid?
So as we got into the hype of generative AI, I think initially it was all about experimentation, but now it's about expectations. What we can do from a content creation, content generation. My role in marketing is all about how do we engage our consumers with the personalization at scale, customization at scale, which wasn't possible and easier before. With generative AI, it's now, first of all, expected from our leadership team to be able to prove the value of it at scale. Then how do we take it to our consumers, where consumers care about it, because now we are giving them just more than personalization. We are not treating somebody like, hey, Philip, but we are able to give you the right message at the right time with the right offer by understanding you, and we can do that at scale. And just 5 days ago, we launched a very first campaign for Snickers with Mr. Jose Mourinho. I don't know if you guys have seen it. It's on snickersowngoal.co.uk, where people can go and rank their friends by the own goal their mate have scored, and then generative AI will create a personal message for their friend, which they can share the link with their friends and family for just, again, another way of how we are using AI to, on a day-to-day basis now, to encourage and increase the scale of personalization.
It is brilliant as well. After we had our pre-talk, I tried it, and it's really good. So definitely worth a look. So having a company called Dragonfly AI, it probably would be a bit remiss if I wasn't using a lot of AI. I shouldn't say this, but I've decided I would, is that I'm actually quite old, I realize, because I was doing AI back in 2002. That's when I did my degree in artificial intelligence, and back then we thought that by 2010, everything would be changed. So we're a little bit late, but we got there in the end. And I find my day-to-day usage of AI is huge now. I mean, it would be, as I said, but I see myself as a prompt engineer, which is the new cool phrase for people who know how to talk to ChatGPT in a meaningful way and get a result, because I was a really bad software engineer, so it allows me to make up for lost time. And then, obviously, in our application in Dragonfly, we use AI heavily to predict where people are going to look. So it's pretty much everywhere in my day and my name.
Awesome. And so, you know, to kind of like slow it down and go a little bit deeper with you know, your kind of cross-market view that you've got, and an understanding of, you know, what tools are out there that are delivering, you know, the most impact that you've, you know, started using recently. And just, you know, a little bit about our frame. So it's there now, you know, we run a lot of audio ads that we get people to engage with using their voice, and you know, a tool that we've been kind of looking at and then starting to use over the last couple of years is delivered by a company called Audio Stack, and that allows us to give a very simple brief, and it comes back with a script, and then it generates an AI-generated voice, and it masters a soundtrack. So within 10 seconds, we can create a 30-second audio ad that's, you know, ready to play on the radio, and that makes it a lot easier for us to edit existing creative or create new creative. And so that's, you know, that's something that's kind of impacting our day-to-day. But you know, I know you've got, you know, a unique view of the world. You're incredibly omnipresent in the marketing sphere. So a little bit about who you're seeing doing what and what tools are you using really useful.
So there's a lot that we're seeing, especially on the venture capital side of True. So I'm personally quite excited about what's happening in contextual and conversational search. So I personally hate shopping. I hate walking around the shops for hours. If I know there's something I really need to get, you know, pressed for time and having to run around, I hate doing that. But I know if I need something for a specific, if I'm going to a wedding or, you know, doing something I need a specific item for. So contextual conversational search can essentially enable you to search, let's say, 1,000 stores within 3 seconds. So if you want, you know, a suit for a 1920s party that you're going to, you can just put that in and it will really bring up different, you know, like the suit, the hat, the suspenders, and really help you in what you're looking for. So that's really interesting to me at the moment. Also a company called Associate AI is doing that quite well at the moment. Also a company called Miros, which is doing wordless search that's based on user behavior. So I think in terms of that the way search is changing, a lot of people are now shopping through social, through blogs, so they're no longer actually just going to a retailer and trying to find something. So I think for brands, looking at how you can be relevant in the search that people aren't looking for your brand is really important, and Associate do utilize AI to help with tagging, so it's no longer reliant on human kind of input, which really helps there. But yeah, there's hundreds of companies that are swimming around my mind at the moment. There's another one that we're invested in called Sea Change, and they use computer vision technology to help with retail theft. So that's a huge issue in the retail industry at the moment. So obviously the cost of living is putting a lot of pressure on people. So a lot of, you know, whether it's smash and grabs, we've seen a lot of runs on different stores, you know, in Oxford Street, you know, through TikTok, where people are essentially coordinating crime. So Sea Change essentially helps to use that computer vision to identify certain behaviours in store, or also from a safety point of view, whether it's slip and fall. That's some tech that we've put into Walmart in the States, so to help protect people and obviously stop people from suing companies, which is helpful.
Well, so there's an awful lot in the wild.
Yes, very much so. Grab me afterwards, I can tell you a few more that are going through my head.
And so yeah, Sid, I'm sure that like you get pitched the whole time. You know, people want to work with you and provide you with something that you've never seen before. It's going to change your world. You know, what's landing with you?
So a couple of practical applications that we are seeing outside of, you know, text to display and text to video is how we are able to now get better at e-commerce channels, where the expansion of quick commerce partners, especially in global emerging markets, it's crazy. The number of partners we have to put our products out, create the product detail pages in their formats, in their expected image variations. We are now starting to see partners coming up with predefined templates where you can use a single source file for a SKU, and it can generate product content pages for hundreds and hundreds of retailers using these templates. And then it also gives you things like what image is right for which platform. It gives a score. So we are seeing from a content copy creation perspective, writer.ai, copy.ai, jasper.ai being the great guys there. In the image optimization, of course, Visit is a key player who gives you the measurement of how your assets and products are performing on the likes of Amazon, Walmart, Target, Sainsbury's, Tesco's, and global emerging markets like India. You get same channels, but partners like Blinkit and so on. And so that area is coming up quite nicely in addition to what we've seen from a marketing perspective. The other area that we've seen some really good expected outcomes are the innovation space. How do we get better using Google Gemini Pro 1.5 million tokens and ChatGPT 4.0, that now we can give it speech input and it can create synthetic personas for our audiences or our consumers, and we can ask it questions as we would do a consumer panel. Mm-hmm. what are their preferences, what are the, and then we can match all that with industry trends of keywords, and then come up with some really good snacking ideas and snacking platforms that we can then prioritize for launch. So those two areas, apart from marketing, are really, really coming to life.
They were really great. I have no idea how I'm going to respond to that. Obviously, we're super passionate about what we're doing in Dragonfly on vision and AI. But I think something which I've been focusing a bit of time on lately has been the open AI for good movement. I don't know if you've seen this, but where companies like Dragonfly and others are able to submit their AI IP and others can use it for not for profit or for good or for charities. And I feel like there's a lot of attention to what we can do for good marketing things, and that's incredibly important. We need to do a good job, but I am really pleased to see that there's a good movement by good people of trying to reuse this technology that's been invested in then for good, and then opening it up in channels in a way. So I think there'll be some amazing applications in the next couple of years that will really genuinely help society based on the things we're learning in marketing. So that's kind of where I'm excited. I think their answers are much better than I could have given.
Awesome. So we will be able to open up to some questions at the end. The way that we will take questions is through the Slido app, which is in your app. So please throw some questions if you'd like to hear from the minds we've got here. So look, I just want to try and get some definitions. So, where are we within the AI hype cycle? And, more specifically, AI is everywhere. I think it's too much everywhere, and it's becoming a bit of a catch-all to just tech we don't understand. So look, this is the technology, so this emerging technology and AI stage. And, I might argue that AI is just the new word for emerging technology because, you've got, AI that can clone your voice is now called voice cloning. We used to have AI that could work out which face is which and put a name to it. That's called facial recognition. So, there is a definition that was put to me that is AI just the word for technology we don't have a name for yet? And if so, should we think about it differently? And, what are the dangers of calling everything AI and just funding AI for AI's sake? How bubbly are we? How far at the peak of the top of the hype cycle are we? Discuss.
So I would say the amount of companies that have been raising or that have emerged with .ai in their addresses has definitely spiked, and we're seeing a lot of companies that are saying they're AI-led, they're AI-driven. When you look under the hood, that might not necessarily be the case. They may just be, doing things digitally in a way that has been done before, but it's a new way of marketing it to get a bit more recognition there. So I would say as a definition, it's defined as tasks that are done by a machine that are commonly, associated with humans. So in terms of how that comes to life, it is very varied. I think we all definitely in this room and, in this festival need to be very conscious of the fact that we are hearing it all day, every day. But when you think about different markets around the world, you think of cold spots in the UK, they may not be hearing it as much. So I think when we might be saying, oh, it's everywhere, how much is it actually being used by your everyday consumer and what is their appetite for that kind of innovation? And I think making sure that we are addressing that for the appropriate audiences is important to consider.
Okay. There was a speaker earlier that said that AI is very good at doing tasks, but humans are really good at doing jobs. And so, that could be a useful way to frame things as well.
Yeah, I think in any loop, the humans, thankfully for all of us, still needed. And I think that's definitely, but need to be factored in, and you shouldn't be sending anything out. I think it's important to move fast, but get it right.
So I think all of us can sit here and talk AI tech all day long, but one aspect I want to touch upon is the behavioral changes that we need in the business to scale it. So brand teams, marketing teams, they are used to writing a brief that goes to an agency, but before now with the technology's advancement, we can send that brief to an AI to at least create some storyboards, some concepts. So that cultural change from a hype cycle perspective, Charlie, that's still quite the beginning. The technology is obviously, we are moving at the speed of tech. As our chief growth officers keep saying to us, we need to do business at the speed of tech. But the cultural changes that need to be made in businesses such as ours, large companies, they are still at the, at the cusp of getting started. So we can talk about AI all day, but without those changes in the way we budget, the way we think of creating content, the way we approach technology on a day-to-day basis needs to be changed. So from my perspective, I think that hype has to be given some more oomph to catch up.
I want to dig a bit deeper into, you know, you work at quite a large organization. You know, how do you hack that problem? How do you hack that problem, the process, and get your voice heard if you're trying to champion new ways of working?
So initially, it was all about AI all day, every day, everywhere. And I recently attended an MIT webinar where there was a statement made by a faculty, and it so resonated with me that earlier this year, companies were trying to do a $20 million AI transformation with $2 budget. So it resonated because, you know, everybody in my company is asking me, hey, when are we launching text to video? But before that, we need to have the right investments to be made to be able to scale. And also speaking to our other peers, some have done more MVPs than the others. Nobody has really been able to truly scale it. So we are all trying to find our ways in setting up the right governance internally, to changing our processes. So we are looking at how does our briefing process work today, and where does AI start to fit into at the right intersecting points so that we can then start to have those behavioral shifts come in. So we are looking at process-led, but we are also looking at how do we change our commercial models, our budgeting models, so that all markets, not just the biggest markets like North America, China, all our markets, even the smaller one, can actually take advantage of the tech.
Very cool answer. I really like, Chaudhary, what you said just now about it's called AI because it isn't a thing yet. And I think there's, you know, that trend lifecycle is absolutely right. Being called Dragonfly AI before the big wave came, I was just like, no. Because you know that everyone's going to ask you loads of questions about AI. We don't want to talk about AI. We want to talk about what we can do with it. We want to talk about the fact we can predict what people are going to look, and that's going to improve, you know, the throughput of marketing. So it was a bit disappointing, to be honest, when this whole AI thing kicked off, because we thought we had something, and now it's still in our name. But I do think that, you know, I do think there's a lot more left in the hype cycle, and the reason is that we haven't reached expectation yet. If you look at the internet hype cycle, which then turned out to be good because we all use the internet now, it's quite important, but there was a time where it overstretched what it could actually achieve at the time, and that's where people got, you know, the wave stopped. I've seen ChatGPT-5 in use. It is just scarily good. I think there's still more to come to surprises, so I think the hype cycle will stay while that exists.
Awesome. You know, but we've seen, you know, when you're saying as a marketing tool, we're seeing kind of big brands using, you know, just AI as a way to market their product. You know, Samsung are using that to sell more phones as AI. You know, all the voice assistants that I grew up with over the last 12, 15 years, they're now becoming AI assistants. So I think, you know, that as a marketing tool, it's useful. But, you know, just always interested in how to improve my nomenclature. We've got a question from the audience for all of you. You know, do you see a shift with more female-led Gen AI startups? And if not, what can we do to level the playing field? I mean, you see a few pitch decks. What's the kind of skew that you see coming through, and what can we do to redress the balance?
So yes, we definitely have a good amount. Could there be more? Yes, and I think for me in my role, I really seek out opportunities. So Associate is a company I mentioned before. The founder, her name's Yasmin. So a big part of my role is, you know, developing different partnerships, getting some of our portfolio companies or some of the corporates that we work with out speaking on panels. So I do go out of my way to ensure that, you know, she is getting the opportunities as much as other founders may be. And I think that is important to I guess level the playing field a bit and ensure that we are creating space for that. And I think it comes into, you know, around what data we are feeding AI, and I think having diversity at play, thinking of who are founding those kind of companies, is really important, because there's a lot of AIs that are out there that still don't recognize black people as the same as, you know, if you say, you know, create me a beautiful woman or what is an ideal X, the data that it's been fed on is still, you know, quite homogenous. So I think having more female founders, more diverse founders, I don't think it's just a gender thing. I think it's around disability, it's thinking about age, it's thinking about background, and I think we all need to lean into that. So how can we support those founders and ensure that future of AI, and in the same way as, you know, when the internet was being built, what do we want it to look like? And collectively, I think we need to think about all of our roles in that.
I think I second to everything Danielle said, and I was also pleasantly surprised. We were at CES earlier this year, and the number of female leaders we met who were founders of you know, incubation startups. It was a good compared to what we have seen historically in CES. I was quite pleasantly surprised, but more needs to be done. Not just female leaders in AI, but generally female leaders in tech across the board at all levels, you know, whether it's a CEO role, whether it's a CIO role, whether it's a CTO role, data science, data. I think there need to be leadership across for females across every organization, and I think more needs to be done there.
Really well said. When I look at our people in Dragonfly, I can see some people here. I know they're going to go on to be CEOs of startups because they're entrepreneurial, they're smart, they've got like... So, you know, we try and make sure that when we are opening a role that we will sometimes score a female higher because we're trying to get the balance right. And I think that's okay. You know, when I first thought of it, I thought you had to create kind of equality. But actually, I think you need to give a bit of a push to make sure more people, more females have the opportunity. And it's been brilliant. It's like it's a much better place to work now. And I really hope that, you know, I can see some of you guys here, that you go on to be the next CEOs of organizations as well.
And we've got one final question when we're wrapping up. And this is a little bit about the output of AI, specifically in the fashion industry. So is AI-generated design authentic and credible, specifically in fashion? Personally, I don't mind. Right, as long as it creates something that I'm happy to buy and makes me feel good and possibly look good, that would be how I'd look at this. But what do you think about AI-generated fashion?
I'll start. Yeah, I think it depends because there's a lot of different applications of that, right? So I've seen when it comes to Shein, for example, if they've got a product which is selling really well, they have different AI tools that they will use and say, okay, we're going to use this cut of a dress and we're going to do it in a different fabric, in a different colour scheme. And they'll look at different trending data to then create something that will tap into those trends. So that can be quite interesting. We've had a play around with a few different tools, which are text to image based. They do punch out some interesting items for sure, and I think everyone's seen the Will Smith video of the kind of text to visual. Has everyone seen that? Show of hands. Yeah, it's essentially him eating spaghetti. If you Google it, it was quite frightening where it was at a couple of years ago. But then with the launch of ChatGPT's video product, you can really see how that's evolving. They had someone that looked like they were on the moon. There's only, yeah. It's improving. It's improving by the day. But I think an important thing to consider in that is just that we're not just creating more waste and tapping into overconsumption. I think it should very much be created for the demand that is there.
Awesome. I think we are just at time. So are you going to have to approach and reach out to these guys directly if you want to understand their attitude towards AI-based fashion? But it's been a really, really interesting discussion. I've enjoyed it immensely. If we could just have a show of hands, say thank you very much for Danielle, Sid and Steve.